Well, it was very difficult to find out what we wanted to show, but so I made a tour of the hollow of the foot. And but the idea here is to discuss this, to analyze and discuss the ideas. Now let's start. Well, first of all, I have to put my name. I call it like that to give it a name, and that is my name. This Guanalo. Now, I'm going to talk about a little bit about the Mayas, so I might as well mention that we are going to talk about mainly from the middle classic to the early classic. I mean mainly the early pre-classic. Late post-classic and early post-classic. This is the time. These are the Christian dates. And these are the Maya dates. It's much more older. I mean, there is a lot of tradition in the Maya culture. And as a beginning, I would like to point out that the Maya cultivate the swampy lands by raising fields and canals, extreme productive and sustainable. They also cultivated steep slope, flat lands, rocky limestone, which is the case I'm going to talk about. Well, this is a map where we are. This is the Yucatan Peninsula, perhaps you know, map of Mexico. And the Maya cover all that area. You have the limestone plateau, the Yucatan Peninsula is a limestone plateau. You have also some flats here, very flat land, swampy. And also we have mountains here, volcanic, on a volcanic area. So I am in my emphasis is on this area. And you have the main agricultural system used there is the milpa. Milpa is a mixture of crops, mainly maize, beans, several fasciolus, mainly vulgaris and lunatus, and a squash, at least two different species of squash. So it's a polycrop. Yeah, I mean, this is the most popular ancient structure we have, which is about a late post-classic. It has some Toltec influence already, but the interesting thing about this is that when there is the equinox, the sun comes on this corner, and you can see the back of the serpent practically going down the stairs, which is very well oriented, extremely well ubicated. Can you see that the shadows here? Well, it reflects on the walls here. When they're the equinox and the solstice. Is that English, solstice and equinox? Mm-hmm. Sometimes I don't know. Excellent. Well, this is the place where I work. This is a village called Yashkaba, and that's a village from the 17th century. And it's distinctive in the sense that it has three towers. The middle was used because that was the line in which the last battles between the Spaniards and the Mayas took place, and they lasted for several years. They had this big tower to find sometimes this village was on the Spanish side, and the other one was on the Indian side. But when I say the Spanish, it is not only the Spanish by itself, but all the Mayas who adopted the Spanish way of life. So there was a fight between the two groups, and the top of they had this big tower so that they would see when the armies were coming from one side to the other. It's a very interesting church. Also, it has this part here, I don't know, the balcony has here, and the Spaniards used to go inside the church, and the Indians used to listen to mass on the outside. And also on the altar, also in English, they have a stone, and the people who behave badly, they put it in a cave and they put the stone on the top of it. And this church were built by the Luneros. Luneros is the Monday man, because in the time of the well, after the conquest, in the colony, they have to work one day for the comendero. All men in the village, men in the area. Well, I'm going to talk now about the traditional Maya production unit, which is made for milpa, which is rain fed, the rainforest, selva, is not English, Spanish selva. Do you use selva as well? Well, there's a, in the, they get maize from this area, mainly maize, as I say, cucumber,
squash,
calabasas, in the rainforest they get, they still get some, they do hunting, they get some protein, animal protein, and they also get firewood, herbs for curing. They have also irrigated plots, usually of 1 hectare, which at the moment are abandoned. They have apiary, which is the most productive system at the moment. And they also have managed to get daily wages. Also inside the house, you have women working and sewing and That means that the traditional has a part of self-production, that's correct, and also commercial production. The honey is mainly sent to Europe, to Germany, because it's a very good quality. We claim this is the best of the world. But when you compare with the Argentinian honey or the Chinese honey, it's terrible actually. It has a lot of aroma. It's delicious actually. Well, this is the slash and burn part of the milpa. Milpa is produced by the slash and burn agriculture. And this last day, moon landscape, doesn't it? But I started working on this. And I arrived to the conclusion, and this is under discussion, or we can discuss it, is the best technology to use when you have time to make the land rest at least 18 years in that area. Remember that burning is an oxidation process. I mean, you have carbohydrates, and then you decompose them in water and carbon dioxide. And in that area, we can estimate that you have about 260 tons of organic matter, and they produce 731 tons of carbon dioxide. Because when the carbon mixes with the oxygen is very heavy, and it produces way more. And you have 260 tons of carbon and 60 tons of carbon. Carbon dioxide is on the top and carbon is in the bottom. So it's a lot. So also you lose about 1,000 kilograms of nitrogen in terms of nitrogen dioxide and about 100 kilograms of phosphorus. And about 600 kilograms of potassium, and about a ton or 1,000 kilograms of calcium. So that is you fertilize the area with that. When you burn, you are fertilizing the area. Sorry. You are adding fertilizers to the area. The problem is that The use of shifting cultivation is not to fertilize the soil. It is mainly to control the spontaneous vegetation, so the crop will have not other weeds to compete for light and water. And that is where you end up. It's very interesting crop because you saw all the seeds together. But first it comes one species of calabaza.
Pumpkin.
And it covers the ground very quickly. And it also shades the weeds, so it lowers the growth rate. Then after you get the maize start growing, and after 40 days the first crop finishes practically, and the maize start growing. And you know, maize after 40 days that you have no, if you don't have weeds higher than high, they will develop very well because they will have no competition. And you have the fasciolus,
the beans,
and they start growing very slowly around the stem. And then after the other species of pumpkins. So at the end, you first crop the first cucumber, then after you crop the maize, and when the maize is ripe, they put it down and then they bend it so that it will get dry. And this is the time where the fasciolus and the other pumpkins start to develop. And it takes the rains you see, fasciolus is an extraordinary plant, gender, because when it is dry, they lose their flowers. But when there is a little bit of rain, immediately they get fertilizers and they produce a lot of rain. I think I'm going very slowly, I'm sorry. Well, that's an example of a type of honey and the way, that's an apiary, typical apiary. 10 to 20 colonies, and that's the type of panicker she's produced. And so, now, I'm going to talk. That is one subject. The next one is a home garden. And it's my colleagues who've done the work. You know what a home garden is. Is what you say. It's an enormous potential for food security, human nutrition. We explore that. Well, after we've done all the work, what we arrived at the conclusion was that the number of components, we call it, I mean, components are what type of production lines you have, depends on the number of children the family has. If they have many children, they cannot attend the home garden. And also, well, that is the simplest model. And the second model says that the number of components is inversely related to the number of children, and also if the man goes out and works. Well, it has no relationship with any other element. Only the number of variables depends on the people. Of course, I mean, it's logical. If you have too many children, you cannot look after the garden. Well, that is the woman. This is, well, at one stage we organize a community bank. And these are, you know, we need to see what sort of people we are in there. Well, now I'm going to talk about, to see if I can get through you about this transdisciplinary paradigm. Reality can be seen in terms of ecosystems. I hope you agree with that. A system, ecosystem, is a system and its environment. It's an indivisible unit. Systems is controlled internal and external by internal and external variables over time. So they are dynamic and the causes become effects, which is a very different approach to the other approach, the reductionist approach, which I think you are working along those lines. Processes. Variables act, interact, and react between the system and between systems and its environment. Now, we are going to talk now the relationship between independent variable and dependent variable. If we are going to talk in terms of system, we have to talk in terms of processes. And the processes is the variables act, interact, react in the system and between this system and this environment. Now, you see reality, I mean, you go to the microatomic level, this is in Spanish, I'm afraid, but you have the subatomic level, the atomic level you have the atoms, a molecular level you have the substances, then after you have the mitochondria, the cells. The cells are grouped themselves in simple organisms, and then these organisms become more and more complex. There is reality, we can see it in terms of systems, not in terms of independent and dependent variables. I was for me to remember. The physicist, well, it's the same that I said before, sorry. The other complexity. I mean, systems go from simple to more complex systems. I mean, an atom is a very simple one, but when you go to a human being, we are very complex systems. In fact, the human beings, we can interpret reality in terms of actual models and abstract models. I mean, physical models and abstract models, which is a very large contribution, really. Now, I just point out that the ecosystem is a unit. This is the simplest example. You have the cell of an organism, and you have the wall, which is inside the wall, there is the system. Outside the wall is the eco, the environment. But this is an open system. I mean, it is always exchanging energy or whatever you want between the environment and the system itself. Well, now I'm going to change the subject completely, and I'm going to try to talk about another project, which is called Undernutrition Prevention in Children Less Than 2 Years of Age, which we're carrying out in Yucatan. Nutrition has been a serious problem in Yucatan, Mexico for centuries, isn't it? We started working in participatory processes with 20 mothers to understand what was the cause of undernutrition. Before that, we studied the relationship between food intake and nutrition, and there is no relationship. No relation at the village, local village level or at the state level. And we have all these statistics you can think of to try to show, to try to find the relationship, but there is none. Well, that was I'll go back to this. But the point is that a child is a system. And the system doesn't depend only on the way it goes into the system. Depends on what it goes into the system. Once it gets into the system, it can be used either on maintenance, the first priority is to keep the system going. Maintenance, You can use it for growth, you can use it for, you can store it, or you can use for reproduction. In children, reproduction is not, there is no difference between the sexes, the boys and girls. They are that age, less than 2 years of age. So it is used mainly in maintenance, growth, and storage. And we think it's only used, when you say that there's a relationship between food intake and growth, it's only in these terms, which is not the case. Reductionism works when variables under study are most limitative and other variables are kept constant. I mean, reductionism, it is one case, a special case of complexity. This is a classical experiment. I mean, I take a group of people and give them a treatment, and another one give the same treatment, and we see if there is difference between them. All right? You are with me, I hope. I hope so very much. So, complexity of transdiscipline studies events, actions, interactions, feedbacks, determinations. Between the human being and his environment. Complexity does not disregard reduction, it is seen as a particular case. In terms of systems, complexity sees the whole and its parts. But action research, that is a, well, perhaps you are familiar with it, is the only ethnographic method which helps us to construct the future. Most of the ethnography is built on the basis of distinction between object of study and subject of study. And in doing that, we separate ourselves from the rest of the people. And that means that we cannot participate in building up the future. Well, for example, this is the results of one boy. You see, here we measure the food intake, which is this one on the top. We measure their nutritional state, which is this one. I mean, I am using zeta values, so the nutrition should always be on zero. The normal boy will be always on zero. So you can see here, it is a good, well-fed boy, actually. And it goes up and down, the amount of food it takes. But we also measure the height for their age. The child grows, but I mean, you can express it in terms of sets. And it gives you also, if it's just along the normal boy will go along the zero value, right? And we measure also the symptoms, not the illnesses, the symptoms. And we can see a very strong relationship between the amount of the increase in the symptoms and the decrease in the food intake. Because symptoms go down and the food increasing. And here you have an increase, a food decrease and increasing symptoms. Here you have an increase in symptoms and decreasing food intake. So the children, and it's the same boy, now in the hot season, it is the same principle. And every time the child stops, increases the symptoms and decreases the food intake. There's a girl which is very often ill. Symptoms. These are the symptoms. And that is the food intake.
Did the PVR receive very little,
but it's continuously ill. Now, we learn that you have to stop undernutrition in children in that village. You need, first of all, to prevent illnesses, to prevent symptoms. Secondly, we have to improve their strength by feeding and care. Thirdly, when they get ill, we want the number of days which the child is ill to decrease as much as possible. And secondly, we have to make conscious in the mothers that the convalescence period is a very, very important, because if child gets the symptoms again, it will be far more difficult to recover it. Well, with that knowledge, now how are we going? We learn it with 20 mothers, and there is a village of about, between mothers and grandmothers, about 1,200. So how are we going to get all that knowledge from these people to the rest of the people? So we are thinking in a marketing, social marketing. And again, well, commercial marketing, you are very familiar with it. It's what makes us smoke and drink and take Coca-Cola and everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just bought a Mac because I saw it in the cinema. Everybody uses a Mac, so why shouldn't I use a Mac? But social marketing aims to strengthen people's innate desire to improve the quality of life through reasonable changes in current behavior. I mean, it's a change in behavior. Both individuals and society can profit from these changes. This model, we describe it principally in terms of ecosystems. Systems is the environment, as an individual unit. Internal and external variables, which I have said already, and Pratt and they have said that. We use participatory ethnography that records environmental decision between subjects. Some of you are familiar with ethnographic systems? All right, excellent. Well, psychologists understand behavior as a mental process which drives the operation is thought. I mean, we change. Changing behavior involves making decisions. Basically, decisions controlled internally and externally by the physiological, psychological ecosystem. Psychological system, I think it's been studied by the psychologists, but this is a continuous, at least of four elements. Conceptions, we need to know what we are talking about. This is also modulated by values, emotions, resources, which includes language, customs, habits, traditions, and ends. Goals we are trying to get. Externally, this ecosystem, this is the sociological system, the ecosystem is mainly the sociological ecosystem, which basic operation is not thought. I mean, the social system, the basic operation is exchange, mainly of information. On those bases, we try to construct this decision-making model, which, as I said, so the four elements, conception, values, resources, and ends, and they are acting all the time, even when we are asleep. And you have to introduce some kind of energy, mainly by calling their attention. See, and then after you have to to make them accept and maintain this. And the idea here is that the only way of changing habits is by repetition. And it gets us to the fact that the decision-making model is formed of two, an automatic and an impulse control. I mean, we react, for example, we always, when we're something which puts in danger our life, we react by our automatic system. And it's all to control when we reason or we learn things. Automatic is effortless, associative, emotional, fast, and action-oriented. The control requires effort, illogical, mainly, rational, slow, but coherent. Changing habits involves transition between automatic and control extremes, attention, automatic, reflection, verification, and adoption, if we are lucky. Well, that's it. I talk too much. I show you a tour of what I think we are doing, and I am prepared. If you have any comments, I will be glad to try to answer them. Thank you very much.